These have been challenging times, but the body of Christ has proven itself resilient. We've gathered in different ways, in different places, yet stood steadfast as the church. We have found peace in God's promise to never leave us or forsake us. In our separation, we have remained united. In our struggle, we have lived out our faith. In the midst of the unknown, we have leaned on the strength of an all-knowing God. Throughout history, the church has thrived in adversity, and this moment is no different. The power of God is unstoppable, His love unending, His grace unrelenting, His glory undeniable. Today, no matter where we gather, we remain God's people. Our mission has not changed. Our calling has not been altered. And nothing, absolutely nothing, will ever change that. We are the church, and today we stand resilient.
Good morning. As your pastor, I just wanted to share some things with you that are important to all of us. You probably know, you should know, I trust you know, that a week from Sunday, we will begin our first time together within the sanctuary. And if you haven't taken an opportunity to make your reservation, now would be a good time to do that. I also want to say to you that if you've decided to stay home, I don't want you to feel any guilt about that whatsoever. I want you to feel free to come and worship with us, but I also understand that for some people, that's just not an option yet. And so please feel free to be led by the Spirit. That's absolutely fine, and you will not be held in judgment by others. And let's just pray together that all of us will get to the place where we can come here and not be worried about the effects of the epidemic. And so just know that your committee has been working diligently to make the sanctuary as safe as it possibly could be in terms of ventilation and in terms of people sitting too close to one another. So a whole lot of work has been put into this. If you are coming, I think you can feel safe about it. But if you decide to stay at home, that's fine. Just participate in the worship service from there. Thank you very much, and I'll look forward to seeing some of you personally, and hopefully all of you sooner than later when it comes on a personal basis. Thank you.
Good morning. Here are the announcements for Sunday, July 12, 2020. Supplee will be offering a Fellowship in the Field event on Monday, July 13 at 7 p.m., weather permitting. Bring your own lawn chairs and remember to bring your masks. Jeff Carson and Dave Caddick will be on hand to discuss how they have been blessed both personally and professionally. Come listen, share your thoughts, and pray together. The event is open to all our Supplee family and friends, so please invite others. Please continue to keep the family of John Kopp in your prayers as his family prepares to celebrate his life this week. Pastor Don will once again be offering his Monday morning prayer Zoom meetings. Join him Mondays at 11 a.m. via Zoom. Please call the church office for the login information. As of today, Supplee is planning on offering our in-person worship service on Sunday, July 19 at 9:30 a.m. Please check your email or call the church office to reserve your seat at this service. Due to social distancing, there will be a limited number of seats available. Also, please remember that masks will be required. In conjunction with this, beginning Sunday, July 19, we will be switching our online service to a part live, part recorded service. The online service will stream live at 9:30 a.m. on Facebook and YouTube. More details will be sent to you after today's service via email. You will recall last week I announced that Session has authorized me to, in lieu of a special meeting of congregation, to advise you of the candidates to serve on the nominating committee as well as to serve as elders and deacons. This is the second reading of those nominations. To serve on the nominating committee, the following have been nominated. To represent the Session, Chuck Wormington, who will act as chairperson, and Janice Brunner. To represent the deacons, Amy Wollerman. Representing the Women's Association, Jen McKnight. Representing Sunday School, Amy Reef. Representing the men of the church, Arthur Freeston. And representing the church at large, Warren Stork. This will be also the second reading of the nominations for those to serve a 3-year term as elder. Nada Kale, Sue Kim Chmielewski, Jay Eibner, Russ Hensel, and Joshua McKnight. And the following have been nominated to serve a 3-year term as deacon: Tony Hagendorf, Derek Hopper, Linda Lutz, and Melissa McVoy. In an effort to move this process along, I make a motion at this point to close all nominations for the nominating committee, the elders, and deacons.
Second.
And I also make a motion that the congregation elect those nominated to serve on the nominating committee, those nominated to serve as elder, and those nominated to serve as a deacon.
Second.
After today's service, the congregation will be sent an email to vote for those that have been nominated. If you do not have an email address, those individuals will be sent the ballot by way of first-class mail. Thank you. And now let us worship God. The call to worship this morning is from Psalm 95, verse 6. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, in these troubled times, we thank you for technology that has allowed us to continue to worship you in a corporate way, yet still maintain safe distancing. Be with us as we enter the green phase of COVID-19 protocol that will be the beginning of our reopening of the church sanctuary for worship services. We ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Hey, Supplee kids, Evan here. Super excited to be doing your children's moment today for our online church service. Thanks so much for watching with us and everything. So this morning, I want to take a moment and talk about something that you guys, honestly, as kids may have never heard of. And so that's something called a rerun. So back in the day, before you had Netflix or Disney Plus and you could binge watch whatever show you felt like watching, you would turn on TV and they would just be rerunning old shows that have already aired. And then in between whenever the new episodes came out, you literally just watch reruns. And if you liked something enough, you had no problem rewatching the reruns. It wasn't like there was a new show all the time. You just watch reruns because that's what you liked. And so I grew up, loved this show. I grew up watching reruns of Seinfeld with my family because that was something that we enjoyed enough that it didn't matter how many times we had seen it before. It was always great. And so why am I talking about reruns? It's because I realized when I was sitting down to do today's children's sermon, I feel like every time that it's my turn to do the children's sermon, I find myself doing the same thing, right? Like I feel like every time I've done this, we're talking about the same thing. And that's because right now, that message is so important. You know what I mean? I think in America, and like you guys are so used to, I'm not knocking on you guys, but you're used to always having something new. especially because you guys got Netflix and you got Hulu, you got Disney Plus. You don't have to do reruns. You don't have to watch the same shows over and over, but sometimes it's important to watch the same thing over and over and hear the same message over and over and really remember it and really practice it. And so right now, again, as Christians, what can we do? People around us are hurting, and there's so many different conversations and things going, swirling through your minds. Your rerun for your life needs to be Bible verses like in Luke chapter 14. I love it. Jesus kind of says, hey, if you're having a party, if you're having a feast, invite the poor, the hurt, the lame, people who you don't like. Right? And that's a parable. You guys aren't planning parties right now because of COVID. But Jesus is saying, hey, be with people who are different than you, who are hurting, and help them. Right? That's literally what we can do as Christians. Be around people who are different, guys, and help them. People who are hurting. Listen to others. Wear your masks. Another great thing in Luke 14, he says, pick up your cross daily and walk. That's a super weird, strange passage. What does that mean? I'm just a kid. How do I pick up a cross? That literally means do things you don't like because it makes other people better around you and it makes God happy. Really easy stuff. What can you do right now? I don't like wearing a mask. It's itchy. It's hot. It's July now. Hate it. But if you love God, you love people around you, you want to keep them safe, wear that mask, guys. It's a great way that you can love Jesus and you can help people around you. Just little things. And again, I know like this is pretty much the same children's service you've heard the whole time we've been on quarantine, but it's so important to help other people. Like we're all stuck in our houses and we're all quarantined and we're all hurting. But there's still little things that we can do where we can show Christ's love to everybody else. So that's what I have for you guys. And I really, 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 really hope you aren't tired of hearing it. Let it be on repeat before you. Let it be your rerun that you should help those around you. Thanks, guys.
Our scripture reading this morning is Luke 5, verses 1 through 11. This is where Jesus calls his first disciples. One day, as Jesus was standing by the Lake of Gennesaret, also known as the Sea of Galilee, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from the shore. He then sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord, I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people." So they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. Thus endeth the reading of the scriptures.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, speak to us today through the empowerment of your Holy Spirit. Allow your word to be etched on our hearts and minds, and then enable us to practice its truth in our lives, both this day and all the days ahead. For we pray that in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. I don't know, it was a few weeks ago, I watched a special on the life of Michael Jordan. One of the things that I knew, but it was emphasized again, that was Michael Jordan was obviously a tremendous basketball player. And it was interesting to hear some of his teammates describe the type of workout or energy that he displayed. They said that he went through mental gymnastics, physical gymnastics. He went and drove himself hard in order to be ready for each game and to be at the best that he could be. This snapshot in his life also revealed that Michael Jordan didn't start out at the top. In fact, we are told that he was cut from his ninth grade basketball team. I would imagine that since that time, whoever the coach was must have some interesting conversations with people that he meets. Witnessing Jordan's rise to the top, his rise to fame, reminded me, though, of a biblical character, and that biblical character is none other than Peter. We see Peter at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. And that Peter is a far cry from the Peter that we encounter in the second chapter of Acts after Jesus has risen from the dead. If all we had in the way of information about Peter was what is contained in the book of Acts, we would be a little bit misled. We would have a cloudy view as to what Peter was all about, because Acts tells us that he had major accomplishments. He was a very effective preacher. He was even a physician of sorts. He was a prophet, as referred to the fact that he would not give in to the Jerusalem council and to their authority. Instead, he said, "The authority in my life is Jesus Christ, who you crucified and has risen from the dead." Finally, in Acts chapter 5, we see the pastoral part of Peter as he confronts Ananias and Sapphira about their dishonesty in order to make sure that the church, the early church, would remain pure. If Acts were the only resource that we had about the characteristics of Peter, our perception of him would be misleading and one-sided, for we might assume that Peter came from an exceptional family, an exceptional background, and that he had exposure to all the right people and the right experiences, that he had tremendous natural gifts. But the fact is, there's a lot more recorded about Peter than just what we find in the book of Acts. And it's in the light of that information that we want to examine Peter as well. Because there was no exceptional family. There was no great treasure trove of gifts. There was no Jerusalem prep school. None whatsoever. When we see Jesus confront Peter for the first time, it was going to be a long way, a long journey to the kind of Peter that we would discover in the second chapter of Acts. A long way to the preacher, to the physician, to the prophet, and to the pastor that we would see Peter become 4 years later. But there were times when any observer would be convinced, watching Peter in the early days, that he simply didn't have it, that he was going to fall short, that he wasn't going to make it. And so this morning I would like us to focus on the beginning of that process. We're going to go fishing together to the point where Jesus puts that first challenge about discipleship for Peter for the first time. I want us to examine that experience because we might be able to identify with some of what Peter went through during his pilgrimage, and that we might eventually become effective and worthy for use in the kingdom of God and discover what God has called us to do. The passage that we read from Luke's gospel in chapter 5 is the first passage we have of any significance in terms of Peter and Jesus being together. Peter is put on the spot and asked to make some quick decisions in this encounter with Christ, because he was going to be asked to leave his home and go and follow the Lord along with the other disciples. The setting for this confrontation between Peter and Jesus is an interesting one, and it shows us some of the characters of both personality of Jesus and of Peter. But what's most fascinating is the way that our Lord is able to use the most commonplace circumstances to be able to make his will come about. For we are told that it's morning and the fishermen had just come in from fishing all night. In essence, you might say that they were working the night shift. And if you've ever worked the night shift, you know that can be a very tiresome experience and it can be very demanding. Any of you who have ever worked the evening shift are certainly aware of that. On top of the fact that they were coming in now from a night of fishing, this was also the busiest time of the day. All the people on the shore were now getting their breakfast and their food for the day. In Jesus' day, there was no refrigeration, so people bought their food on a daily basis. The busiest time of the day. Tired and worn out, the fishermen had come in exhausted, and they had also come in empty. They did not catch any fish. Lucky for them, however, the people had already focused their attention on Jesus. The Gospels tell us that wherever Jesus went, there was always a crowd that was following him. And so Jesus found himself becoming a little impatient with the size of the crowd that was gathering. They were not, even in Jesus' day, practicing social distancing. And so the crowd had grown large. And some of the people wanted to maybe get a photograph or get as close as they could get. Everyone wanted to get a little piece of Jesus. And so in the third verse, we are told that Jesus, in order to deal with this, selects one of the boats. It happens to be Peter. He says to Peter, "Peter, I want to go just a short distance from the shore." I can think of three reasons why Jesus would want to do this. Obviously, he was distracted by the great crowd of people that had gathered. So that was going to be one reason why he wanted to get in the boat. Secondly, getting into the boat, to Peter's boat, and getting out a little on the water would enable him to have a sounding board so his voice would carry for all of the many people that were gathered there that day. And then finally, and maybe most importantly, it was a means by which he could identify with the people, with their daily grind, with the fishing that they had to do in order to have subsistence for living. And so he was particularly identifying with the skills and the professions of these men who fish every day and had come in tired after catching nothing. And so what we see in the life of Jesus is that he knew how to get things done and he knew how to gather his disciples together. In short, Jesus knew what he was doing, and that becomes evident as we read through more and more of the passage. Peter was probably pretty glad. He may have been euphoric about having Jesus use his boat, because now some of the pressure was off. They didn't catch any fish, but everybody was looking at Jesus and not at Peter and the others. And so, obviously, Jesus was popular with the crowd. Who wouldn't jump at a chance to be in his ministry? Who wouldn't jump at a chance to make a contribution? Maybe Peter was thinking that his fish factory down the way would benefit from this encounter with Jesus. If Peter had only known what he was in for that day as he rowed away from the shore. Jesus chose this particular time, this particular moment in Peter's life to give him a special invitation. Peter was not prepared for that invitation. Peter, put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. Master, we toiled all night and we've taken nothing, but at your word I will let down the nets. The others were merely listeners, but Peter was now being put on the spot by Jesus. Let's think about that situation that Peter encountered that day, because maybe you have had a similar one. Maybe you've been in a crowd of people, maybe even in the sanctuary, and you've heard the voice of the Lord or the power of the Holy Spirit saying to you that maybe you should do this or maybe you should try that. And maybe you think to yourself, is this God's Spirit speaking to me? What if I respond? But what if God's Spirit really isn't speaking to me at all? I would simply be embarrassed. I would simply feel like an outcast. And now you have encountered Peter's problem, Peter's major characteristic that always seemed to get him into trouble, and in a word, it was pride. We see it in Peter's response to Jesus. Jesus, paddling around the shoreline here is no big problem for me. I can do that. And if you want to ask us to do that, we can do that for a while. But, you know, Jesus, you don't understand fishing and boats and nets like I do. What is Jesus thinking? This is Peter's job. He knows it from A to Z. Doesn't Jesus have any regard for the fact that Peter is a pro when it comes to fishing? Doesn't he have the least bit of sympathy for the fact that Peter and his helpers are tired? Peter's pride is at stake. Everyone Peter knows is watching him, and now Jesus is going to put him on the spot in front of everyone else. Jesus is good with theology, maybe healing the lame. He is certainly good with taking care of the sick. But what does he know about fishing? Certainly he doesn't know more than Peter. Can't you hear Peter saying to Jesus something like this? I don't want to offend you, Lord, but when it comes to fishing, I know more than you do, and you have gone to the limits. Note Peter's reply in verse 5. It's practical, it's shrewd, it's clever. Master, we toiled all night and took nothing. It's human logic at its finest. Peter is inferring to Jesus that he is the expert. And when it comes to fishing, he knows a lot more. Look, Jesus, the lake is simply not yielding fish today. Can't you see that? We're tired. We've tried this before. Lord, we've been wearing these masks for 3 months, and what difference has it really made? And there are plenty of people who don't wear them whatsoever, so why do we have to be put on the spot? Why do we have to have this situation in our lives? That's the way a lot of people are, individually and as churches, feeling that I've tried so hard to meet your expectations, Lord. I taught a Sunday school class. I'm trying to be faithful in my business. I tried to even share my faith with a neighbor and that went nowhere. I tried to show concern for the problems in the world, and like Peter, I came up empty. I've toiled all night, Lord, and have taken nothing. We're all like Peter in one way or another, setting up our case, setting up our reasons for why we can't accomplish this or why we can't accomplish that, settling for the safety of the crowd instead of making decisions. Poor Peter. Poor, poor Peter. Why did he have to be the one on the spot? Why was he the first one chosen and no one else? It's important that we also look at the second half of verse 5. Lord, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word we'll let down the nets. Because at first glance, one might get the impression that this was his Damascus Road experience, demonstrating faith in Jesus. I suspect this is not a revelation of Peter's faith, but rather it's an incident where Peter is trying to put the blame on Jesus. Jesus, if we didn't catch any fish, this wasn't our fault, it was your fault, because you asked us to go out into the deep. So now, if things fail, it won't be Peter who looks bad, but it will be Jesus. But the boat eventually went out into the deep. And as Peter and his helpers lowered the nets, they found out that the nets were full. The scripture says so full that their nets were breaking. For Peter, this was not only a time of invitation, it became a time of revelation. And so we're told that Peter fell on his knees before Jesus and said, "Depart from me, O Lord, for I am a sinful man." And he was aware both of his sin, and he was aware both of the wonder and the majesty and the special nature of Christ. What was it that changed things for Peter? It was his desire to see through the message of the miracle. If Jesus can fill boats that quickly and that full, well, imagine what he could do in my life. Imagine what he could do in your life. Peter, like most people, was cautious in his response to Jesus. Immediately, there was a sense of confession in his part that he had doubted Jesus in the first place. But there was also a sense in which Peter was saying to Jesus, "Jesus, you're into some things that I don't know that I'm worthy of, that I don't know that I am ready for. I don't know that I'm ready for all of that blessing, all of those fish, if you will. I'm not that good of a person. I'm simply a fisherman named Peter." But the Bible doesn't teach that Christ only picks superstars or that Christ only picks good people to develop his will. It does teach that a person must be ready enough to periodically go out into the deep. It does teach that a congregation must periodically be willing to go out into the deep in order to follow the lead of Christ. And that's exactly what Jesus told Peter. "Don't be afraid, Peter, out here, because I'm not going to leave you. I am going to be with you through all the circumstances of life." The beautiful conclusion to this passage is when Peter and his helpers come to the shoreline. They had left everything and were willing to follow Jesus. It didn't mean that somehow fishing was evil or that it was not a good profession. It was simply a case of something greater, fishing for people in order to be able to experience change in their lives. So what about you? What about us? What about me? What are the deep places in our lives where we have been resisting? Maybe it's pride. Maybe it's a gift that we have that we've allowed to go dormant. Maybe it's simple fatigue. Maybe it's a host of things that we keep using as an excuse. Could Christ be asking us today, as the body of Christ, or even as individuals, could Christ be asking us to let down our nets? We know what happened to Peter. The nets became full. But what if they didn't pay attention to Jesus that day and cast the nets over to the other side of the boat and just remained in the boat there with no great catch, no excitement, certainly no experience of following Christ, just doing the same thing they did every day without giving much thought to it? Too many of us follow that in that way. We're clutching on to certain nets. Maybe it's the fact that we've really wanted to have a wonderful relationship with Christ, but we only want to go so far and we don't want to make the big step. Maybe it's nets of stewardship. Oh, I better protect my money because I'm going to need it. I don't know that I can part with any more money. Maybe it's a simple gift or a talent that you receive from God that you've allowed to go dormant and to not use anymore. Whatever our nets may be, Christ is asking us to lower them so that he might be able to fill them. If you read the first few chapters of Acts, you couldn't help but be impressed with Peter. He was an unbelievable servant of the Lord and very gifted. But remember, Peter didn't start at the top of the class. Just like Michael Jordan, he had his moments when he wasn't at the top at all, when he struggled. And so be a Peter and be willing to let down the nets and let go of the things that you've been holding on to that prevent you from Christ enabling your life to be full, just like the nets became full that day. Amen. Let's pray. Father, as we look at this important passage today, we realize that over the years you have called us to go out into the deep. And sometimes we have responded and we have found that to be a great experience when we share in ministry with you. But sometimes because of our pride, sometimes because of our timidity, we have backed off from taking your invitation seriously. Or we've said, let others do it. They are more gifted than me. But the reality is, O Lord, that when we allow our pride to get in the way, we miss out on your blessing in our lives. And so we pray that you'll help us to be consistent about things like wearing the masks and doing the social distance thing, so that we might be leaders in what it means to be faithful. Help us, Lord, to help those who are all alone and feeling like they have been forgotten in these days. Help us to be ambassadors for Christ. Amen. May the Lord's love, may the Holy Spirit abide and abound in your life in such a way that you will not feel that the net of your life is empty, but rather that it is full and that you are at a place in your life where you're willing to share the love of Christ with others. Go out in his name today. Amen.